we're going to kick things off with our first presentation. And to be part of this presentation, your name has to be Rick. So it is no coincidence that we're going to welcome up Rick Farina and Rick Mellendick. Rick Farina is a well-known wireless expert. He's a frequent speaker at DEF CON, and he runs the wireless Capture the Flag, along with Rick Mellendick, who also runs a wireless village together. Rick is a senior product line manager for Aruba, and together with him is Rick Mellendick, who's the chief security officer at PI Achievers. That's a process security and improvement firm out in, I believe, in Baltimore. And they are the developers of Cyber Resilience Assessment Methodology, otherwise known as CRAM. And Rick is also an SME in computer network operations, RF offensive tactics, and a number of areas. Today, they're going to talk about the wireless offense and defense, make it explained, and demonstrate it. Ladies and gentlemen, warm RSAC conference welcome for Rick Mellendick and Rick Farina.
Thanks, sir. Hi. It's
Hello.
Great to be here. Any more Ricks that want to come up? No? Just us? Okay.
So, as we were just introduced up, this is our BIOS. We throw them up there because this is RSA. I do a lot of stuff in RF. We've built a couple tools that are pretty cool. We're going to talk and show them today. Go ahead.
Yeah.
Who are you?
Yeah. I'm also Rick. We do wireless stuff. We're doing a lot of wireless stuff over there, so if any of this is interesting and fun, you can actually play with it when you come over to the Wireless Village, which we're very proud to have at RSA for the first time.
Yeah, this has been great. You have the ability to actually do a lot of the things and see a lot of the things that we're going to show up on stage today. We have an active kind of wireless shooting range to allow you to go after wireless networks. We've got some RFID stuff if you want to play with that. We've got some Bluetooth devices as well. So come on over and check us out. So the Wireless Village, we've been around for about 15 years. We're a group of volunteers that are put together to kind of build out teaching and showing and giving people a good opportunity to play with wireless technologies. We don't just look at wireless as Wi-Fi, though. We look at wireless as the whole spectrum. We want to make sure that people understand that that is the risk posture that you're dealing with. And we're going to show some tools that show why that's a problem today. Talking about Discord?
Yeah, so at DEF CON, I was asked by one of the attendees, hey, where do you talk to other people about this stuff? And I said, oh, crap. That's a great idea. We should do that. We should have a place where we can all talk to each other and figure out how this works. So rather than just following us on Twitter, which is a terrible medium, or reading our blog occasionally, we actually set up a Discord server, public, anyone can join, and we talk about threat management and wireless attacks and new things. And we're just kind of always talking about software-defined radio and Wi-Fi and Bluetooth and all that stuff in there. So we set that up, we made it public, and since then we've got about 250 people on
it. Great.
And it's been a really great place to meet and greet.
So real quick, caution. This is one of our stickers over on the side. If you like this, you think it's as funny as we do, please come over and grab it. But that being said, if you are in this room, you will be part of the demos. We are doing radio frequency demos. We are explaining the security, offense, and defense of RF security. That being said, if you have a device that is RF and you do not want to be part of the demos, we're not going to be active in any way, shape, or form. It's all going to be passive, but you will be part of these demos.
If it transmits in the air, we're probably going to pick it up, just FYI. Yeah, I guess I'll do this one. This is my favorite comic strip from one of our other team members. We use Pentoo Linux because I write Pentoo Linux. It's a Linux distribution meant for penetration testing with a special emphasis on wireless because I do wireless stuff. This has actually been around for more than 10 years. It's the longest-running penetration testing distro. It's hardened. It's got security updates. It's meant for real use, and it's what we use for all of the stuff that you're about to see.
And the really good news about it is, as an assessor, it also has a full version of OpenOffice running because, you know, Rick knows that some of us need to actually do this for real work, and this is all being done on OpenOffice. So for what it's worth, it does a great job, and this is RSA's full slide deck and everything else. So offense and defense explained, or knowing is half the battle. Either way, you are knowing that you have half the problem because you have the problem in your pocket right now. You have the problem on your lap. You have the problem on the desk in front of you. These are all things that we want you to be aware of because they are what is creating your digital footprint as you're moving around this earth. So, you know, the body of meat and water that you have walking around is a target to some people. And somebody told me one time, they're like, hey, you know what? I'm not a target. I'm just a guy. I'm just doing this, X, Y, you know, whatever. I go to work every day. I said, do you have a bank account? He goes, yeah. I said, okay. Do you need it? Do you want it? Do you want to keep it? Well, yeah. Okay, cool. Do you live somewhere? I don't care if it's a house, an apartment, a condo, whatever it is. Do you have a key to the front door? Is it electric or is it keyed? Do you have things inside that you care about? Okay. Do you have a vehicle or do you ride in a vehicle, whether it be a train, plane, automobile, whatever have you? That is all part of your attack platform personally. So as we start talking through this, we want you to look at it from a personal perspective, but then think of it from a corporate perspective too. We like hitting people first and then talking about the business because typically that makes people open their eyes and say, oh, I'm not the one that wants to be captured today. So Wireless Village, we're over here, we're at DEF CON, we're at a whole lot of conferences, but we're called the Wireless Village because there's so much more to wireless than just Wi-Fi. Most people, when you think wireless, wireless security, who in here typically would say, oh, it's just my Wi-Fi and I've got WPA2, so we're good. I mean, that's a pretty normal answer that we hear. We're going to show you today why that's really just a tiny little bit of it.
All right, so we're going to go through a couple of tools. Again, the demos are available in the Wireless Village, not just to look at, but to touch and play with. So this stuff we're going to talk about on stage, but there's also room to come over and really explore these a little deeper. Also, in addition to the fact that this is on Pentoo, which is a free open source Linux distribution, and we're using OpenOffice, which is a free open source office, all of the software we're talking about primarily is open source. Kismet being the work of the great Draghorn, AircrackNG being the work of Mr. X and a small team of people, including myself. These are tools that are around for a long, long time and have been updated and maintained, and especially Kismet's gotten a pretty massive facelift recently.
Yeah, I mean, we've been running it. If you've been over to the Village, you've seen it. Rick's got an implementation of Kismet that we believe is the largest implementation of unique radios into Kismet, into one interface. But what's really cool now is not only do you have that one interface, but that interface can be shared with the rest of your team. So if you're doing monitoring of your network, you can have your SOC, your NOC, and your engineers all looking at the same interface, looking at channel convergence, look at hopping, look at where everything's going on, but also see DDoS and disassociation attacks. We were laughing earlier, and you know, Rick works at Aruba, and they do an amazing job. They make phenomenal access points. But not everybody has the money to put in enterprise-level wireless. If you're in a small business, you've got a whole lot of offices, or you're in a place that that's just, that doesn't make sense. A tool like Kismet can give you the monitoring that you need, at least at a high level, to see that something's right or wrong within your space.
Yeah, the first thing we noticed actually turning on Kismet was it was constantly alerting, and I'm like, oh man, all my stuff's broken. I can't believe oh, wait a minute. That's the access points in here channel hopping every 5 minutes. Yeah, it turns out that the implementation that they're using is not really great at deciding to pick a channel. So it just puts all the APs on one channel and then decides that one's too congested and then switches them all to a different channel. Works great.
So this is Kismet and this is Aerodump. Kismet being on your right-hand side, Aerodump being on the left. Aerodump is a really nice kind of big picture, big net, look at what's going on. One of the demos that we are showing is actually the bottom portion of that screen. It's a little tough to see because, you know, big picture, big screen. It shows the probe requests coming out of a device. So every one of your devices that's ever joined a wireless network in the past, because of convenience, thank you, Microsoft, Apple, Android, they want you to reconnect back to those access points really quickly because it cuts down on their need for bandwidth. It gives you the ability to have a faster connection when you're somewhere where you don't have good cell phone connection. But it makes it so that you're vulnerable to somebody coming up and saying, oh yeah, hi, I'm that access point you wanted to join 6 weeks ago. You should come join us now. On the right-hand side is Kismet. Kismet is showing in a web interface the ability to see all of those networks at the same time. It's a different view for a different reason. Different security, different monitoring, different ways of doing things.
Now, the Aircrack suite is really meant for reconnaissance in the nature of I want to crack into this network. Kismet is meant into a reconnaissance for how is all of this working. So Aerodump shows you, like, this client is connected to this AP in that little list that's tiny on the bottom, and it's harder to read and it's hard to track and those kinds of things. In Kismet, there's a click on this access point. Here's a list of all the clients that have ever connected to it. Here's a list of the clients that are currently connected to it. So one is meant for running full-time and passive recon and understanding what's going on and tracking changes. And the other one is instantaneous. I want to attack these things. Which one of these do I copy and paste so I can attack it?
So, like we said, that was about 10 minutes. That's the extent of the wireless Wi-Fi that we're going to talk about. Now we're going to talk a little bit about Bluetooth, and we happen to have somebody speaking a little bit later today that is one of the guys that I specifically wanted to speak today. He is going to be talking about Bluetooth architecture, Bluetooth engineering, Bluetooth reverse engineering. But since Mike's not on stage right now and Rick is, I'm going to let him take it because he's done some pretty neat stuff there too.
Yeah, Bluetooth. Bluetooth is great. Totally works great as long as it's going from my left ear to my cell phone in my left pocket. That's what they call class 2 Bluetooth. It goes about 3 feet. Supposed to go farther than that, but it totally doesn't. This was meant to replace like wired devices, so I don't have to have a wired headset, so I don't have to plug my keyboard in, so I don't have to plug my mouse in. Bluetooth was meant for those low-speed devices, low-speed transactions, and to deal with just replacing cables. As it grew, they decided, hey, you know what's great? If we do high-speed too. So Bluetooth 1 morphed into Bluetooth 2 and Bluetooth 3 that added more high-speed capabilities, more data transfer capabilities, and really bloated and sped the battery decay by adding in all these higher speed options. For a headset even, you really don't need high speed, but it's like, well, we could make it better quality, so let's just throw way more into this and make it suck the battery a lot faster. And that's where kind of Bluetooth Smart comes from. Bluetooth 4, Bluetooth Low Energy, is really a completely different protocol, redesigned. It's a fully different modulation even. It's a different protocol designed for battery life more than anything else, which means not that it doesn't transmit as loud or it doesn't do the cool frequency hopping stuff that Bluetooth does. It actually only changes things like how often you need to talk to maintain that solid connection. So you can do things like sleep for 250 milliseconds and then wake up and send one packet and then sleep for 250 milliseconds, whereas the regular Bluetooth standard doesn't allow those kinds of things. So those deeper power saving states are really what it was designed for your smartwatch, for your Fitbit, so those devices can get longer battery life because they really just don't need that high-speed data transfer. So Bluetooth cards obviously come in all kinds of shapes and sizes. I think it's really important to note your Wi-Fi card that you pay for, you pay like $36 or whatever, $50, and these come almost always with a Bluetooth chip on them. That's your laptop's got an integrated Bluetooth into the Wi-Fi card. Bluetooth is designed to be about 5 cents for the radio. It was designed to be very cheap, and that's why it's not always great, because they're designed to be very, very cheap, and that gives you a much different market for them. The device in the middle is a Senna UD100. It is a Class 1 Plus Bluetooth device. It is rated for 1,000 meters. I don't think that that's quite accurate, but it is by far the longest running, the longest traveling Bluetooth I've ever used, and it'll pick up pretty easily everything in this room from the stage. So as we said, you're part of the demo. The last one is a true Bluetooth sniffer, which is quite impressive because Bluetooth channel hops 800 times a second, give or take, and that makes it quite difficult to track. This device can actually figure out the frequency hopping map, frequency hop along with you, and dump the data. So it's a pretty useful device called an Ubertooth 1. It also works great for Bluetooth Low Energy. The one thing it doesn't work well for is those high-speed Bluetooth devices, which honestly are pretty rare, because although they wrote it into the standard, nobody uses it, because if you've got a headset, you want to use it to actually take phone calls, not just listen to music. Bluetooth connections are a very special thing. Again, it's not like Wi-Fi. I used to do work where I would see like standards written for security, and they would take like the Wi-Fi standard, and they do a find and replace, and they put the word Bluetooth in, and like, we need to do this. They're not the same thing at all. They're not meant to do the same thing. They don't work the same way. Bluetooth devices, again, are meant to be very, very cheap, so the capabilities of those devices is much, much lower. That's why you can get a Bluetooth radio for 5 cents, but an Ubertooth 1 costs $100. To do those kinds of sniffing and whatnot, you really need to do a lot more than the Bluetooth radios do natively. And just generally, they don't work like Wi-Fi. You can't just spoof a D-off packet and knock somebody off, because the first thing you have to do is figure out where on earth they're going to be and then send that packet fragmented across a half dozen channels. So it's quite fun to do Bluetooth stuff. We're going to do a little demo of a tool called Blue Hydra. This tool was written so that you could find Bluetooth devices. That was the general purpose of it. Since then, we kind of realized it was fun to play with and added in some tracking capabilities. Go ahead and just, yeah. So we added in some tracking capabilities, finding devices, sorting based on signal strength, gathering as much information on these devices as we can, and just Isn't this a demo next? Yeah. Okay, and it also has a specific fox hunting mode. Right. In default mode, it's going to look for as much information as it can, which requires extra polls to the device saying, tell me more about yourself. I want to know what's going on. This is all in the help, too, so you don't necessarily need a picture of this slide. I try to document things when I write them. So a few things that are fun to know. This is, again, all in the README file for the project because I try to document things. There is a config file. You can change things like which Bluetooth interface. Do I want my internal? Do I want my external Senna? And then you can also change things like the filtering. Examples, again, in the README. And if you don't read the README, I promise you'll get it wrong because this file, although it looks really simple, is actually in a language called YAML, and it's really ugly to write strings in YAML. So. And then it's got a database backend for those of you that really want to dig in, gives you lots of information about those devices. And yeah, you're not going to be able to read that here, but if you want lots of data, I have saved lots of data for you. Yay, demonstration. This is the most fun. So again, you are part of the demo. Feel free to make your Bluetooth say something really funny. It's going to be on stage, and we're not filming this part. So go ahead and sort by name just to be funniest. Nope, too far.
All right, so there's at least two charge twos in the room. Most of you that probably
wave your hand
said,
if you got a Fitbit, come on.
That's right. If you didn't want to be part of this, cool, but your phones and other things still are, and that's kind of the problem with this. So people say, oh, I'm just going to turn things off. Well, there's a Galaxy, oh, Note 9. You haven't gotten the 10 yet, sorry.
I like the Samsung 6 Series TV. That's good.
Yeah. So that's
there's only one of those.
Samsung. Yeah.
That's what's funny is we all have huge TVs for
they're
our setups,
LGs.
And I don't. Yeah, they're all LGs.
SFLP clack.
That is a laptop.
Pete Cook's iPhone 7. You hear? How you doing,
Patrick? So, Paul.
The point behind this, folks, is your data and your name potentially are in the air, and they're in the air because your devices are broadcasting this information. In most cases, the default settings on your devices are your name and blah. Your name iPhone, your name Android, your name Note 9. Your watch, you notice Apple Watch isn't coming up as a name. It's in here, the MAC address is in here, but the Apple Watch doesn't come up as a name where some of these other devices do. It makes it easier to start targeting people. Now, as this starts to grow, we'll let this run for a little bit. There's another laptop in here. If you notice about halfway down, the one that says CLBR, let's see if I can mouse over to that. Oops, this one here. There we go. So where it says CLBR right here, those are classic Bluetooth. We'll get back to that in a minute. That's going to be a little bit important in a couple seconds.
That's those of you actually turning your phones into discoverable mode just so you show up on the screen. The BTLE ones show up because they broadcast an advertisement 4 times a second. My favorite part of that standard is it's in there where you broadcast an advertisement that says, I am discoverable or I'm not discoverable. So 4 times a second, you say, you can't see me, you can't see me. And you can just ignore that bit and just show it anyway.
So what's interesting about this, frankly, is that, you know, A, Rick had the idea to do it. We've had tools like AeroDump. We have the AirCrack Suite. They've been around for a really long time. We never, as assessors, as pen testers, as hackers, whatever you want to call us these days, we never had a tool that was like AeroDump for Bluetooth. There's a whole bunch of suite of tools that were out in 2003 and 2004 when we were doing our research, and we were starting our cars remotely over Bluetooth, and it was really neat and fun. But now we're getting into a point where everybody's carrying these devices with them wherever they go. Well, in a lot of cases, we have clients that are targets, high-value targets in some cases, and they need to have protection. Well, they've got guns, gates, and guards following them. They've got people with funny earpieces and squiggly things coming off. They get into armored cars, but while they're walking around, they've got all of this information. Autonomous vehicle. Hey, cool. They've got all kinds of information that's beaconing out about them. Well, I was in a coffee shop, I don't know, a year and a half ago, and I was sitting down, and I was, you know, just doing some work, and I was testing some tools and, you know, getting ready for some stuff because, you know, why not do stuff in a coffee shop? And the next thing I know, a gubernatorial candidate for the state where I live walked in, and it was his name iPhone, and then his name Tesla, and then his name iPad, and then his name. So I walked up to the gentleman. I said, sir, I've got your information here. I know who you are, I know where you are, and I know what car you're driving because there were only two in the parking lot and one had political stickers all over it. It was really, really easy to document and pick out, digitally speaking, where this person was coming from and what he was doing, and that frightened him. And that frightened him a lot because they have security details that are looking for this kind of stuff, but they're not looking for this kind of stuff. This is the type of thing that we try and educate people about. You know, you have your security awareness training. Your security awareness training doesn't involve showing your information up on a screen that, you know, RSA has the ability to see. Nothing's going on here. Literally, all we're doing is enumeration. But we talk about knowing is half the battle. Those that remember G.I. Joe from the 80s and 90s, that was their thing. Well, you know what? It's still here today. You have half the information that the bad guys want. You're also making it very, very easy for them to get it. Let me roll back.
Oh, no.
What did I do? There we go. So my kids swim. If you have any swim parents or swimmers in the room, swimming means I'm at a swimming pool for 2 to 3 hours a day, 5 to 6, 7 days a week, going to meets all the time. Meets mean I'm sitting in a hotel, sitting wherever. And I was coming back from DEF CON to go to a swim meet. And I called Rick up, and I was like, hey, I got this weird idea. It's like, I don't even know if it's possible, but we've got Hydra, and Hydra's really cool, and we can see things. But what happens when it's non-broadcasting and non-beaconing, and it's Bluetooth? I can't do anything about it. Who's heard of an EMSI catcher? I won't use the other name for it, but an EMSI catcher is something that picks up cell phone by the EMSI number on your phone and gives them the ability to redirect that connection. Mostly illegal for any of us to use unless you're in law enforcement, and in many cases, law enforcement tends to not necessarily be as scrupulous as they need to be. There's been a lot of articles about that. But we can't use EMSI catchers because that's not legal. But all of you have phones, and all of you have devices that have Bluetooth. So, like, let's think of a way. Let's see if we can come up with something. I was like, hey, Rick, can you build something?
Yeah, and here's the kicker. Who turns off the Bluetooth when they're not using it? And that'll be, like, two people raise their hands. But how many of you are actually never using it? Like, I have several Bluetooth devices on me at all times. I never turn off my Bluetooth so that I can still get my text messages on my watch. It's very important to me that I see that. People use a lot more Bluetooth these days, and so even the ones that turn it off when they're not using it find that they're just kind of leaving it on so they can track their Fitbit and track their smartwatch and track their earbuds. And you know, they don't even make phones with headphone jacks anymore.
Yeah.
I can't buy a new phone. I'm just stuck with my old phone. So
what was born about an hour later, Rick said, hey, try this code. He sent me some code. Ran it on my computer because, you know, I trust Rick. Don't run code if Rick sends it to you. I'll trust him, don't you? Ran the code. I was like, hey, this is kind of neat, but it's kind of kludgy. I know you only took an hour to write it, but it's kind of kludgy. Let's do this, 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 and this. He's like, all right, give me like a day. So literally this went from an idea driving down the road at like, I don't know, 10, 11 o'clock at night to a couple days later, an actionable tool.
Yeah, so Bluetooth is very prevalent. Bluetooth Classic devices, even more so. All your smartphones are Bluetooth Classic. And despite the fact that they are not in discoverable mode all the time, once you discover that information, you can use that to track the person. So a lot of you were kind enough to put your phones in discoverable mode, give us your full MAC address, and then we wrote this other tool to track you.
So, Blue Sonar. So what I'm going to do here is I'm actually going to jump off stage. This is the command. So it's Blue Sonar. We tell it which interface we want to use. In this case, I'm using the internal interface on my laptop, which we actually had to perform surgery last night because my internal radio wasn't quite working right.
It broke.
The hotel room's like, boom, 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 let's change radios out, all good.
Bluetooth radios target 5 cents means they also fail a lot.
The target is this phone. It's not you guys. Even though we have Bluetooth addresses that we showed, we're not capturing anything, but we have another one. So as you see, this is actually giving a power rating based on how close I am to that laptop. And I'm thinking this probably still works out here. Oh, wow, it's weird hearing
myself.
Yeah, it's
still pretty line of sight. You got to go pretty far.
So as I walk further away, the power rating goes down. As I get closer, the power rating goes up. And again, going up from negative to zero. So as I get closer to the laptop, as I get closer, I'm on target.
And then walking away again. And then
I now have the ability to see exactly where this device is. Now, where this gets a little bit interesting is, let's say, for example, and now I'm right here. Let's say, for example, you are a good guy or a bad guy. You're protecting somebody or you're going after somebody, and you pick out which story you want to go with. And you see that they're inside of a building that you can't get into. Again, protecting or defending, protecting or attacking. You have a MAC address because you saw we were able to pick up MAC addresses. You know that there's a MAC address of a thing inside of that building that you're interested in. So you set up a block, a roadblock, or even just sit in your car at the entrance to the parking garage, the entrance to the parking lot, the end of that street, and you wait for that signal to start getting closer to you. You don't know who that person is that you're defending or attacking. You don't know what they look like. You don't know their identification. You know nothing about them, but you have a MAC address. And that MAC address came from that place that you want information out of. That information comes to you. You follow that information. You now have an unprotected device, not a person, but an unprotected device that's not in the protections of the organization that paid millions and millions, I mean, go across the street, millions and millions of dollars on the neatest, newest, coolest thing that's going to protect every device that exists. You now have them outside of that space from an IT perspective. Change this story any way you want. Like I said, we're going to write security on the slide. If you have questions about this, we can get into that a little bit deeper. If you have questions that you don't want on mic, we can talk over in the village. This tool is extremely powerful, and it's scary. And it's scary because it gives people the ability to invisibly track you without knowing who you are, but knowing that your device exists.
Yeah, this tool actually, shockingly, considering it's been like 2 hours worth of coding, works well enough to track a cell phone uniquely across all of DEF CON, which is a 35,000-person conference in Vegas. So we just give out a MAC address, and the contestants take their little Raspberry Pi rig or whatever, and they walk around this conference, and they find successfully the person with, I think in this case, a Galaxy 7 or whatever in their pocket. And finding one person uniquely in a crowd of 35,000 is impressive any way you do it, and the fact that it's passively with Bluetooth is far more so, I think.
So with this type of capability, and again, we like to give people the ability to play with these tools. We actually set these up as our capture the flag to give people points and, you know, credit and all this kind of stuff at different conferences, but also to practice how these things actually work. How often do you have 15 wireless access points, 75 different RF signals, and a bunch of Bluetooth stuff and wireless stuff running around on people that you can actually track, follow, find, and politely ask them for the device, and you walk back and get points from us? It's our mission to try and teach people from a security perspective, whether it's offense or defense, because a penetration tester, they're offensive. You know, sometimes they don't shower, they're very offensive, but they're offensive for the most part from an IT perspective. But in order to get good defense, you have to have the offense in play somewhere. And the offense has to be capable. And that's the other key. How many of you have had an assessment where this kind of stuff has gone on? Anyone? It's not normal, but it's important. And it's becoming more and more important as we're going to kind of show throughout this.
Yeah, we're all wearing multiple Bluetooth devices, but for some reason, nobody ever pen tests this stuff. Well, so, I mean, not nobody, but
yeah,
a lot of people don't.
There's a lot of people. There are people that are, and they come through us, and they work with us, and we try and teach as best as we can, and they go out, and they do the best that they can. But essentially, this is kind of what we're looking for. If you could see inside of a building without binoculars, without goggles, and without cameras, you can see MAC addresses, whether they're Wi-Fi MAC addresses, Bluetooth MAC addresses, or Bluetooth Low Energy MAC addresses. How many devices does a single person have? We've actually started to compile those numbers. In the United States, we're looking between 4 and 6 per person. So if you scan an area and you find that there's 64 devices in that space, you can do the math pretty quickly to say what? 1, carry the 3,
8 to 12.
16. 16 people or so in that building. And you know what their unique addresses are. So their MAC addresses, by default, are supposed to be unique. By industry standard, they're supposed to be unique. You can change your MAC address, but they're supposed to be unique. So that being said, we have unique identifiers on things. You get into your car. You start your car, turn it on. What happens? Your phone, typically because the states have mandated it, pairs to something, whether it be your headset, your Bluetooth little dongle that you keep in your car, or your car itself. Now we've got 2 addresses on you that are mobile, and they're 2 unique mobile addresses. Most people get rid of their phones every X years. Most people don't get rid of their cars every X years. You know, it's X plus 5 or 6. So that being said, we now have unique information. tracking a stranger based on a MAC address. And I say stranger because you don't know who that person necessarily is, but you're trying to find them. Finding a target wherever they are. You just set up these sensors. Like I said, at DEF CON, we do a lot of testing. It's 35,000 warm, wet bodies walking around. Water is one of the worst attenuators of RF signal, and people are still able to find them because they set up little checkpoints. People walk past them, little alarm goes off, and they got them. Enumerating Wi-Fi with probes. Now we can say, okay, we see this device, it's within range, and there's a Wi-Fi device. They're not correlated yet, but there's a Wi-Fi device that's beaconing out HH Honors, Marriott, Heathrow Airport, BWI Airport, and San Antonio Airport. Okay, that's
well, I know what he does.
Yeah, right. They're flying over from England. What? For what? Flying into Baltimore, leaving Baltimore, and going down to San Antonio. That is a pattern of life that we now have based on, what's it, 16 numbers? I mean, it's not much information that we need to be able to do this. And don't think if we're doing this that there aren't other groups that are doing it as well. Following a car based on a number. So this is giving, just kind of painting that picture around risk for, okay, best firewall in the world's on our corporate network. We've got all kinds of endpoint protections. We've got this, that, and the other thing. But now you walk outside and this is what your picture looks like.
This is one of my favorite things. This originally came out, and I'm like, this is so silly. Who's going to do this? And then I got one of these devices, and I'm like, oh, my God, I'm going to do this just all of the time. Who has a wireless keyboard or mouse? Did you know that your computer can't tell the difference between those two things? Yeah, they're both just a HID device, human interface device. So even if you have a mouse, you can actually inject keystrokes into that mouse. So these nice wireless mice, originally they were actually completely unencrypted. And thanks to these fine folks, they released the vulnerabilities, and most of the manufacturers fixed the unencrypted parts. A lot of them, however, didn't fix the attacks where you can inject keystrokes that aren't encrypted into the encrypted stream. So you can still just inject keystrokes into most of these devices. Again, if wireless is a very special kind of black magic. So you've got this tiny little dongle that goes in your laptop, and your mouse works totally from like 3 feet away, maybe. But if you're 4 feet away, it doesn't work at all anymore. Yeah. But you put a sweet antenna and what's called an LNA, a low noise amplifier, and a decent bandpass filter to filter out everything you don't want. And now we can see things from like 100 meters away rather than one. So you're happily typing away on your keyboard over in, you know, I don't know, maybe some kind of a war game going on in the corner here, and I'm happily intercepting it over in the wireless village on the opposite side of the stage, maybe inject a couple of keystrokes to help you play your war game. I don't know if there's a company that runs kind of hacking challenges here or anything
something,
like that.
Yeah, maybe.
But maybe they shouldn't use wireless mice. I don't know why. Mouse jack was implemented in Pen 2. It's really easy to use. All you do is type mouse jack, and you can actually install the firmware on these devices, which you can buy for like $40 on Amazon or something.
But wait, there's more.
You can even flash it right onto the little dongle that you probably already have that comes with your mouse. It just won't go nearly as far as the expensive dongle with the LNA.
But because you can actually write that firmware to the device driver that is vulnerable, you have the ability to be very covert. Now, you're not probably, even if you're physical security, if I walk into your place with all this set up, you might say something. We were able to kind of put it in backpacks. We're putting in clipboards. We're good at hiding things. But in this case, all I need is a Microsoft, Logitech, Dell, or Amazon dongle that's susceptible to this attack plugged into the side of my laptop. How many of you keep your dongle stuck in your laptop? And don't raise your hand
Everyone.
If you don't want to, but everybody does because, you know, why? You're going to lose that little thing, right?
Yeah.
So you keep it in there. Well, we can keep it in there. We can be within 15, 20 feet of someone that's got a susceptible mouse or keyboard. Windows 10, fully patched. Name your security tool of choice, and I can write commands to your device to make it do something that I want it to do. And in some cases, I can also keylog you.
Yep.
And then it's all over RF.
Anything you can do with the keyboard, so I can open up a notepad, type out a Visual Basic script that runs a keylogger and uploads the data to my website, and then just run that Visual Basic script and then delete it and just leave it running in RAM. For all of you who are enjoying the free software we're talking about and the free advice we're giving, one more bit of free advice. Inside of those little wireless mice, there's a hole, and that's where the dongle gets stored as opposed to inside of your laptop.
That's right. So the tool is actually called Jacket. Jacket is the one that's doing the attacks. We're going to show this in a second, but this is the help screen. If you just type Jacket in, it's going to give you this information. There's a company that's very good friends of ours called Hack5. They've been really amazing at writing these things called ducky scripts. They have a rubber ducky USB dongle. The rubber ducky USB dongle has to be plugged into a computer. It does all of these same things, but you have to physically plug in. This can be done from 100 meters away. Think of what your office space, what 100 meters in all directions looks like. That's where we have the ability. And don't think because you're on the 12th floor that you're safe, because there's a parking garage pretty close, or an apartment or a hotel or something that's relatively close, they can get to these.
And we have directional antennas.
The good news is you don't have to use a wireless mouse, and wired mice are a lot cheaper. They are not as pretty. Bluetooth mice do not have this susceptibility. It's another MAC address, risk, but it doesn't have the susceptibility, mitigation. We have the ability to defend against this. In some instances, we've gone into clients and we've said, hey, you've got 300 people, and we just saw 195 mice and keyboards. I think this is probably your corporate standard. I'm not suggesting that you go out and spend 195 times 40 for each person, but as these things start to break, don't replace them with the same thing, and at least understand what your risks are. So, why not show it? So, it does take a little bit of time to get this up and running, just because it's got to scan through all of the mice and keyboard.
Why are six of you using a wireless mouse and keyboard in here? You're supposed to be listening to us. Sorry. It's killing me.
If you look at this particular set of attacks, what this is showing the address of that mouse and or keyboard, the channels it's using, how many times it's seen it, when it saw it, how long ago or how recent, and the packets themselves. These have the ability to be replayed, and you have the ability to inject into these. When I hit Control C on this, if this was active, this is a completely muted, this is an enumeration scan, I promise. Don't worry about your mouse and keyboards, although if they're plugged in, they are susceptible. The ones that I would probably look at first would be number 4 and number 6, because it's actually telling me it's a Logitech HID, which means it meets all the criteria to effectively attack. We were talking about Pentoo being an amazing operating system. It's Linux, it's hardened, it does all the things it's supposed to do. Gave training at a conference six months ago or so, and the guy I was doing the training with was writing his slides. We're both running Pentoo, he's writing slides, da-da-da-da-da, lockdown, no ports open, SSH closed, no RDP, no nothing into his system. And I was testing. I was like, here, use my mouse for a second. He's like, okay. He starts using the mouse. I run a couple commands. I created 4 new slides while he's writing slides. He's like, did that really just work? He had never seen it in Linux. So it works in Linux, it works in Windows, it works in Mac. If you have a HID device that's susceptible, and there's a list online, if you go to Bastille's website and you go to the Mouse Jack or to the Jacket page, I think it's Mouse Jack page.
Mouse Jack page.
It gives you the list of susceptible devices. But in a nutshell, it's Logitech, Microsoft, Amazon, and Dell within a specific frequency type and dongle type. That being said, it's better to go look at the list, compare that to what you have, and do it. Or better yet, as we'll talk about a little bit later, have your security group run this tool and check and see if it's a bad one.
Now, this is one of those hilarious, like when you're downloading the mouse driver and you're like, why on earth is this 30 megs? This is why. Because people find attacks against these things and then they need to write a firmware updater and then they need to send the firmware to you and update your devices. So yes, it does work without a driver. The driver exists for a reason though.
Software-defined radio. So now we've talked about Bluetooth. We've talked about Wi-Fi. We've talked about some non-standard RF, non-standard 2.4 gigahertz stuff. We don't have anything up here on Zigbee, but if you come over and look, we're going to show you some stuff on Zigbee. Rick's been monitoring a temperature sensor all week, and it keeps going up and down as the temperature in the room does. It's really neat how it actually functions that way. But the fact that we can see it means that ultimately if we wanted to try to, and we had the approval to do so, we could start going after to alter that. If we make the temperature sensor think it's 40 degrees, it's going to get really hot in here. If we make the temperature sensor think it's 100, it's going to get really cold in here because it's going to try and meet the number that it's programmed to meet, hence the IoT village. Visit those guys. They've got some really good stuff. They're showing how some of this stuff works. Software-defined radio, though, is another beast altogether. Software-defined radio lets us look at the spectrum at a point in time, at a frequency and an amplitude. So we're looking at the actual RF energy coming into the antenna. This is a P25 phase one on a municipal network. That is all of the channels that they had registered with the FCC running them simultaneously. I'm looking at, I think it's, I don't know how wide that is, 5 megahertz of bandwidth, but looking at each individual radio call and the control towers to verify on the repeater what's going on in these spaces. Walked into the client, I said, hey, is this what you have registered? They're like, yeah, okay. What are you doing with it? I said, I'm not doing anything. I just want you to know that we know all your frequencies now. First thing we did when we got here is we checked all the mics. We have all the microphone frequencies. Luckily, nobody's jumped in and done what we can do with these because, you know, it would be really funny if all of a sudden I was just saying bad words or, you know, there were sounds coming out of the mic. But that is very possible to do. In fact, we were talking to the folks over here earlier. There's other ways of encrypting these things to make them a little bit more secure. But the bad guys can see this too. So if we know what you're doing within your spaces, where all of your spikes in power are from an RF perspective, we can start to look at different attack vectors to go after those specific spikes based on those frequencies.
Yeah, software-defined radio has really been an amazing thing to come into the hacking community. They've been doing it for like radio astronomy and a number of other things for 30 years now. But to finally bring this kind of flexibility into the security community has been an amazing change. And I want to stress, since a lot of people don't really understand how this works, software-defined radio means software is written and runs on your host computer to do all of the work except for pulling the radio waves out of the air. Somebody said it earlier, and I thought it was a great example. It's a very expensive analog-to-digital converter, and then what you do with the digital stuff is completely up to you. But literally, it's only telling you at an instantaneous point, this is what the signal strength was on this frequency, and it does it so quickly that you can actually catch the oscillations in the wave, and you can decode that information.
Yeah, I mean,
it's a very, very expensive way to do anything. It's a terrible way to do anything if you have silicon that does it already. Can I pick up Wi-Fi with this? Yes, but I need a desktop computer with 12 cores easily to decode that kind of Wi-Fi at just regular 20 megahertz 802.11g. A Wi-Fi card that does 802.11ac is much, much better for Wi-Fi than the software-defined radio is ever going to be. But I can decode temperature sensors, and I can decode car clickers and garage door openers and all these other things with the software-defined radio because I have a cooling pad on my laptop to keep it from melting, and I can just keep decoding this as fast as humanly possible.
Yeah, if you look up on the far right-hand side, you'll see the bottom is the FFT, the fast Fourier transfer, and the top is the waterfall. The waterfall is kind of what we're used to seeing when it comes to waves and signals because that's what they show in pretty pictures. It's what we show on pretty pictures on the side over here. But on the right-hand side, you notice that there's a pretty strong red signal going down the middle, but the side lobes of that initial frequency have some breaks in them. That's where the person that was on that radio, fully encrypted radio, extremely well-implemented radio, that's where they're talking. That's actually their voice modulating across that radio. I don't know what they're saying, but I know that they're saying something. Well, what we end up talking to clients about in this case is if you have an encrypted radio, you don't want people to hear what's going on. Pretty fair, right? Well, how many people have seen the lapel on security, police, whatever have you? They have the little lapel mic. That's a one watt squawk box. Try and say that 10 times fast. As soon as the signal hits that radio, the radio unencrypts, and that voice goes out. Well, when that voice goes out, that's an unencrypted voice. If I have the ability to use a power rating to find where that microphone is, I have the ability to start listening into their conversations completely non-technically. Literally, I just need to be close enough to listen. And those things aren't quiet. So this is one instance. This is where it gets a little interesting. So this is a different tool. So this tool's about $2,800, give or take. It's a Windows-only tool, uses very specialized hardware. Very, very good for people doing this professionally. This tool is a $18 radio and free software. It's called GQRX. This is locating a frequency hopping bug. And if you look at the pattern of what that thing is doing, that is tough to track. You can't do that with a handheld radio because you've got to be flipping across from 99.28 to 99.3, probably 7 or 8, and you've got to be following that as it's going. That is actually the voice modulation of that signal going across the FM spectrum. That's tough to track. We can see it, which means if we can see it, we can find that device. These devices are dirty, but they do amazing jobs of having somebody plant them into your conference room and walk away. They hop around so that they're not super easy to find. They don't block out FM signals. But this allows us to actually visualize what that looks like. Anything?
Yeah, GQRX is just generally a great software-defined radio tool to start out with. As Rick said, you can get an RTL SDR for between $12 and like $25 for the higher-end ones. And you can just plug this in and start decoding wideband FM just like your car does. And you can feel like you've accomplished something and you spent money and you actually did something with your hardware. And then you can start going really, really nuts with it.
So, brings us to this. So this is a 786 megahertz cell phone call using a tool called PhosphorKnob. PhosphorKnob's not free. The application is. The tools that you need to use there are a little bit more expensive. This is about a $1,000 setup. And it's a $1,000 setup because it's a $500 antenna. It's this guy right here with an EDIS-B205 radio and a little Griffin knob, which I think they usually use for like DJs and graphic
design. Like audio files and stuff.
But what you see here is you actually see the cell phone call. We're not intercepting. We're not taking over. We're not interdicting. We're not doing anything to that cell phone call other than knowing that it's going on. But if you're in a space and you're looking for something and you know they're on Verizon at 786 megahertz in that space and you see somebody on their phone and you see that power, again, another tipper as to a person that you were able to find digitally. Now, what's cool about this is, I'll let you take this one over because this is your baby.
Yeah, yeah, dude, go ahead and start it up. And,
yep.
So this was actually came out of a one of our sponsors, Edis Research, donated for our use during DEF CON, like $12,000 worth of software-defined radio, and built this tool that would just kind of show us everything that was going on. And then they were nice enough to donate a much cheaper SDR for us to tag around and do this kind of cool stuff. So this is doing all of the regular software-defined radio stuff, but the difference is this is actually decoding all of the information, like just showing the fast Fourier transform and the waterfall. It's showing it using the graphics card, using OpenCL. So it's doing it much, 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 much faster than the host CPU can. So you can actually see, like, there's a Wi-Fi packet, there's a phone call, like, you can see the way it works in the signal very, very quickly. In this case, the first thing we did when we get here, which is the first thing I do basically everywhere I go, is see if I can peek my head in the back to where they have all the audio receivers for these headsets and microphones. And just in this case, they had 12 little boxes with glowing yellow panels that each had a frequency on them. So I tried to find the highest one and the lowest one. I went back to Rick. I'm like, yeah, 506 to 533. Let's go. And we just kind of brought this up. They leave these things on all of the time. The only reason you can't hear the host right now isn't because he took his microphone off or even shut the thing off. They just muted him in the back with a little button. There's a little slider. They turned him down. Funny if they miss, but they usually don't. So here you can actually see 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 microphones are physically powered on right now, run by this venue. Some of them might not be in this room, but you can see what's going on. And what's even cooler is some of these are a little more obvious. If you turn it up, you can see the two that are Rick and I.
Test.
Yeah, and I meant the...
The gain?
The gain. So you can see which two of these are a little higher. And if you look really closely, it's harder to see on your screen than on the screens we have down here. You can actually see the modulation of the voice as we speak. And then as we stop speaking, you can see the waveform change. You can tell which mic is which just by watching how much it deflects back and forth.
And as we're walking around. I will say, and I do have to give props, these folks back here are doing an absolutely amazing job. And they've been amazing to work with this week because we've kind of been geeking out between their radio tools and our radio tools. And I will tell you, this has been very, very smooth, which is cool. And we've been able to monitor and verify that it's been pretty smooth this whole week. So, you know, kudos to those guys and thank you for doing what you do here.
Yeah, so we built this out as a demo so that you could, you know, let people touch the PhosphorKnob and play with it and retune it and see what's going on. Like, oh, I wonder what's going on over here in these frequencies, or what? Where do I find cell phones, and what's Wi-Fi look like, and those kinds of things. We built it out literally as a demo, and as I asked Rick to test it for the demo, he's like, this is really cool. I'm going to use this for work. Like, having the little knob and retuning the software-defined radio just feels so great. It's just a wonderful user experience that I just added it to the Linux distro, and it's like, yeah, buy one of these, plug it in, and have a great day.
Yeah, and it's nice, and again, getting into the defensive side, being able to show an executive something like that and being able to point out where pieces are is really, really helpful, and I found it's gotten me a lot of, you know, credibility with them when they say, oh, well, it's just black magic. Well, no, it's rainbow magic, and here's how it works, and here's how I can show it to you. So a couple things that we wanted to kind of leave you folks with. A, we'll be here for the rest of the day. All of this stuff will be set up in, you know, the next half hour or so when we get everything set up, and you'll be able to play with all of these tools, and we'll show you how it all works. That being said, there's a lot of information that someone can capture about you right now. Is your Wi-Fi on? Yes or no? If you're using it, cool. If you're not using it, it's probing out for other networks that you've joined in the past. Remember that. It will cause pattern of life, people to be able to track that information. In Mac, you can turn off, you can forget a network when you disjoin it. In Android, you can actually go in and delete your past connections. But if you're using it, great. If you're not using it, turn it off. Is your Bluetooth on right now? If you did it just for fun for the demo, awesome. If you're not using it, turn it off. By the way, Apple users, that little switch that says airplane mode doesn't turn Bluetooth off. It leaves Bluetooth on purpose because of those neat little earphones that they have and those little pencils that they have and all the neat things that, you know, Apple's brought us over the years. They're all Bluetooth dependent, so they need to be on. Do you have your Wi-Fi set to auto-join every network you join out of convenience? Because that's the normal setting. And if you have that, turn it off. Be a little less convenient and be a little bit more invisible for your own protection. And if not for your own protection, for your family or your company. If you don't care that much about yourself, that's on you. But your family and your company probably do care about people following you home. Believe me, you're not paranoid if it's actually happening. I speak from experience. So to apply what you've learned today, in the next week or so, try and build out a plan to enumerate your wireless stuff in your space, remembering that wireless isn't just Wi-Fi anymore. In the first couple months following this, after you've seen this, you've been educated, you now know, and I think there's something weird about knowing is half the battle that we talked about earlier, but once you know, you do have an obligation to at least attempt to do something correct. So get your security staff trained. Get them familiar with these tools. It's not a budget issue. It's a training issue, but it's not a budget issue. You have laptops, you have spare laptops. The ISOs are free. You can download Kali, you can download Pentoo, you can download Ubuntu. All of these tools are functional. Within the slide deck are the GitHub pages for the other tools that exist. If you run Pentoo, they're already there. The radios, a little bit more expensive, but we're talking 50, 60 bucks. You know, that's not something that's going to tip a budget when you can go back and talk about this level of issue. And then within the next 6 months, you should be building an RF baseline of your organization. Here's what the signals look like. Here's how strong they are. Why is there a huge differentiation today between here and here? Running a diff out of a scan is really easy to do in Linux. It's harder to do in Windows. Mac sort of does it, but Linux is still free. You know, everybody that you've talked to this week has said 500,000, 300,000, 600,000, $1 billion to do our thing. This is all free stuff. We're literally selling nothing. We are trying to tell you that there's free stuff out there to allow you to do this stuff.
Yeah, that's the most common question we've actually had all weekend is we're showing off Kismet, and it's got 10 different wireless dongles feeding into it, and it's showing all this information. The guy's like, how much does this cost? Well, as long as your time is worthless, it's completely free. I spent hours and hours and hours making all this work, but truth is people like me spend hours and hours making it work so that it does just work for a lot of other people. You can plug this stuff in. You can make it work. I spent, 40 hours last week, don't tell my boss, working on Zigbee sniffers, those work in... Oh, this is being recorded, isn't it? Oh,
yeah.
Well.
Yep.
He'll never watch it. It's fine.
I apologize.
So I spent like 40... there's 40 hours in a week where you're supposed to sleep, right? So it's
right.
Fine. I spent those hours working on it and made the Zigbee sniffers work and pushed pull requests to everybody, got them into Kismet, getting them into the upstream for the Zigbee sniffers and making this easier for people to do. It's really worth spending a little bit of time doing it. Rick gave a great action plan for what to do next week, what to do in 6 months, what to do in 5 minutes. If you really think this stuff is cool like we do, our Discord community is extremely friendly. We are not, name and shame disgusting, hackers that are going to make fun of the noobs.
Yeah, like, no.
We are all learning in one way or another. I am very good with wireless. I am very good with Linux. I don't know how to change my background on my work Windows computer. So we're all new at something.
Where's
Eric?
There he is.
Eric can help me
with that. Eric can help us with our Windows.
So join the Discord if you think this stuff is cool and you want to learn more. But beware, you will learn more and you will work hard and you will spend more time on this than you wish you did because you're going to realize how much fun it is. And then you're going to end up building rigs that have 10 different dongles feeding wireless.
Questions you guys have? We've got some time. We've got about 5 minutes. Please use the mic, though.
Yeah. For Wi-Fi, they say use a VPN if you're going to be on a public network. As an attacker, have you found any ways around that?
Yes.
Absolutely. You know that little thing where you say click to agree to my terms and conditions, and your VPN doesn't work before you do that? So if that is, for example, fingerprinting your browser and dropping exploits against Adobe Flash or my favorite Java or whatever you've got installed, yes, absolutely. If you can connect to the network without sending a single packet other than your VPN startup, then you're good. But as it turns out, that's physically impossible because every phone goes immediately and runs their browser components in the back end to check to see if you have a splash page or not. Before you bring up that splash page, I can take over your browser. You don't even have to launch the browser because it's using the same function calls in the back.
So they say that every tool that's free, you are the customer. If you're going to name your coffee shop of choice or your hotel of choice that's giving you free Wi-Fi, there's data being tracked on the back end of that. Worse than that is, and we can show it over here, we have attacks against captive portals. So let's say you log in and it says, please put in your name and your room number. Who's done that once or twice like this week? Well, really, really simple to create that page, give it to you, you put in your name and your room number, I give you internet through the hotel, so it looks like you're going through the hotel, and I'm redirecting you where I want you to go. You turn your VPN on, your VPN's going to fail because I don't want you to use it, but most people get really frustrated when that happens and they stop using their VPN, and they just do work, and then they say, oh, I'll just throw it up later, or I'm going to log into O365 and I'm going to do this stuff. Well, I'm capturing all of that as we go. So be really, really careful with free internet.
Right, and then one more question for Wi-Fi or Bluetooth. Are there any apps that you can put on your phone to keep someone else from enumerating what Wi-Fi points you've accessed in the past, any of that kind of thing?
Yes, absolutely.
Sort of, yes, kind of, maybe. There's a few apps like Smarter Wi-Fi Manager that do GPS tracking to tell if the access point's in the right place and turns off your Wi-Fi when you're not at home, not at work, and things like that. Like, it automatically handles those things for you. Again, hitting forget all of my networks once in a while is not a bad thing because you really don't need a list of 9,000 places you've been. Especially, like, in Android, you can actually manage the list individually. You can curate and say, I want to keep these 10, I want to drop the rest. With Apple, you can't forget a network unless you're in range of it, which is the worst possible thing, so you actually have to forget everything to wipe 5 things off the list.
Yeah, I delete network settings is something I do like twice a week.
Yeah.
It makes me have to remember passwords occasionally, but I delete it like twice a week. The other thing you can do is you can actually run an attack against yourself that enumerates every probe you send out and creates that access point, and then you go in and forget it. But you know, attacking yourself to defend yourself seems really weird these days. Open Signal is the other one that I kind of throw on most of my Android devices, and it shows cell towers, and it shows where cell towers are supposed to be. And if you look at that occasionally and a cell tower has moved, I was talking to a Verizon guy yesterday. I said, how often do you guys move your towers? He's like, we don't move our towers.
What are you talking about?
So if the tower's moving, it's probably not somebody that you want to connect to. We've got 3 minutes, so go ahead. And we'll be here all day, so if you have other questions.
Yes, a question. So to resurface the previous question about the VPN encrypting Wi-Fi, there is a technology that's always on VPN through Palo Alto Networks or whatever that is basically based on your computer certificate, not necessarily user. So it's persistent VPN on. Mm-hmm. Is this would be a viable workaround through, you know, even if you do click on the, I agree to the terms and whatnot, but you already on the VPN as you essentially, before you even log in into your machine.
Every time you're on a new network, you have to reestablish that VPN connection. Yeah. So always on means your phone is going to immediately VPN the second it makes a new network connection, which is a great setting, and I highly advise you, everyone uses that one, because otherwise, like, what's the point of having a VPN if it doesn't establish itself? I'm not going to click that every time. But when you make a connection to Wi-Fi, your VPN needs to make the new connection to there. It might not have to do all the handshaking process. It might have some neat handover to say, I'm using this IP now, accept packets from me. But if there's a splash page or something that's going to prevent the VPN until you agree to the terms and conditions, you still have the same problem. The always-on feature does protect you from the attack, however, because it won't send packets outside of the VPN. You also won't get internet at, say, Starbucks or the airport, and most of these free hotspots require that annoying splash page. But it will protect you quite a bit. So yes, that is good advice to leave the always on setting always on. And then if it doesn't connect, this network wasn't for me anyway.
We actually discourage a lot of our clients to even allow free Wi-Fi on their systems.
Yeah.
There's GPO settings that you can push through Windows. Mac has some settings through Casper. Linux, you do it through systemd or system manager. Allows you to not connect to open Wi-Fi ever. All of those systems are typically open Wi-Fi, so it's an easy thing to just cut out. Most phones today tether. So if they can tether and you're going off a cell tower, and you trust the cell towers, again, levels of trust, you've got that same access. So yeah, I mean, there are absolutely secure ways of doing it. Generic VPN after connecting to Wi-Fi would probably be the best worst thing you could do, because at least you're making a VPN connection. It's either going to fail or succeed. All right, we'll be over here for the rest of the day. We've got a minute left. You guys get a minute back, and we're good to go.